name is Peter Qualiatine. I'm the co-founder and director of Men's Accountability for the Seattle-based organization for prostitution survivors. And it's really great to be here today looking out at all of these faces. I've been doing this work for a long time. OPSA is a relatively new organization. We've been around for only about 5 years. But I've been actively working on the issue of commercial sexual exploitation for going on 25 years now. And at that time, I would never have looked at a room full of so many faces. At that time, there were very few people that were working on this issue. And I even wasn't working on it when I got involved. I was working on issues of domestic violence and sexual assault. I was doing that because I grew up in a domestic violence household. And unlike a lot of people, I recognized pretty early on that although my father's violence became a problem for my mother and my siblings and myself, that it wasn't our problem, it was his problem. It was his lack of social-emotional learning, his lack of an ability to deal with the frustrations that came up in his life, the anxieties, the disappointments, the curveballs that life threw him, and then his feelings of entitlement to take it out on those closest to him, those around him. As I got older, I recognized that this was something that wasn't just going on in my house, but it was going on in a lot of houses. And that it was usually men who were doing this violence. Most men weren't violent in this way, but when people were violent in this way, it was predominantly men's violence against women. As I got older, things happened, like my sister came to me and told me she'd been sexually assaulted, and other female friends of mine confided in me their sexual assaults and their child sexual abuse. And again, the perpetrators were men. Although most men did not perpetrate these crimes, most perpetrators of these crimes were men. And so I really started to understand that there was something about normative ideas about masculinity, what's been come to known as hegemonic or toxic masculinity, that were connected to these types of violence. And so I, early on, in the late 80s and early 90s, wanted to engage with young men to talk about healthy relationships, to talk about violence prevention, prevention of sexual assault, prevention of dating violence. So I trained men and we went into middle schools and high schools in partnership with women's service providers and did these trainings. And that was all great. It's great work. It still is. But I had a big blind spot. Because if you would have come up to me at that time and said, well, Peter, what about prostitution? I would have looked at you funny and said, what are you talking about? Prostitution, what does that have to do with anything? That's a victimless crime. That's something somebody freely chooses to do. I'm not going to tell anybody what they should or shouldn't do. And that's about all I thought about it. But through the course of my work on other forms of gender-based violence, I was brought into contact with an amazing organization down in Portland that was founded by survivors of prostitution in order to assist others who wanted out of a life. And as I started to meet these women, and I started to hear their stories, it started to shift my understanding of prostitution. Because although they were adult women when I met them, for the most part, they had entered into the commercial sex industry. Most had experienced physical abuse, emotional abuse, neglect in the home, had run away or spent a big deal of time away from home in order to escape that abuse, where they were vulnerable, and they were preyed upon by pimps who used emotional manipulation, physical abuse, sexual abuse to gain power and maintain control over these young people in systems that I was starting to recognize were a lot like domestic violence. While they were in the life, they experienced physical assaults, sexual assaults, they were kidnapped, they were tortured, they were mutilated, they were murdered at rates that were off the charts. Their suicide rates were super high. If they did get out of the life, they had a lot of barriers. They had PTSD rates that were twice that for military veterans. There was stigma that they had to face, the judgment that they had to face from people that were there to help. And it made me start to understand that prostitution was not, in fact, a victimless crime. It didn't usually happen between two consenting adults. That it was another form of gender-based violence. So, I'm here today to talk to you about a remarkable group of people that got together about 3 years ago now in Seattle to form what is now known as the Ending Exploitation Collaborative. And we were a group that came together that wanted to address the issue of commercial sexual exploitation and sex trafficking in a holistic way, right? To recognize that this is a practice of gender-based violence. And we had a good model to look to. The Nordic model. Any of you familiar with the Nordic model? Okay. So, I'll back up the truck a little bit further than that. In the 80s, prostitution in Sweden was decriminalized. After the fall of the Soviet Union, as we move on into the 90s, sex trafficking explodes in Sweden. So Sweden takes a look at this explosion in prostitution and sex trafficking that is going on in their country. And they want to take a really unique approach to this. They recognize that the legal regimes that have been used to address commercial sexual exploitation historically have not worked. So they unpacked the issue and started to look at what the problem, in fact, was about commercial sexual exploitation, and they started to recognize that it was both a product of and something that perpetuated gender inequality, and specifically women's inequality. And so what they did was develop an asymmetrical approach to prostitution, where they kept it decriminalized for a person who was prostituted, but criminalized buying, and criminalized pimping and trafficking. It makes so much sense to us now, but at the time it was really groundbreaking. And the thing about the Nordic model is that it has worked. And it has worked so well that it was passed in Iceland, and then Norway, and then France, and then Canada, and most recently Ireland, and Northern Ireland. So I think that we are on the leading edge here in the United States on trying to adapt this model to our environment. And why the Nordic model? Precisely because of what I talked about before, that because prostitution is a form of gender-based violence. So this is our version of the Nordic model that we've developed in Seattle, King County. We deal both with the issue of those who have been exploited. What we want to do with them is to reduce their involvement in the system and offer services and establish alternatives to prostitution, real alternatives, right? The criminal justice system historically has been a barrier that has prevented people from getting out of the life. This way, it becomes a supportive way to get folks into services. What we know is 89% of people globally who are in prostitution want to get out and just need to have the resources and the real alternatives available, and they'll get out. At the same time that we're creating those services, and we'll talk more about that when Heidi talks later, she's going to talk quite a bit about the services. But we're also at the same time holding exploiters accountable. That's both the buyers and the pimps. And we're doing that along a spectrum of prevention that includes prevention efforts, primary prevention efforts, but also includes disruption, intervention, and accountability. And I'll be talking a bit more later in my presentation about intervention and accountability. The third piece, the third leg of the Nordic model stool, you've got services, increased services for survivors, you've got increased accountability for buyers and traffickers, and the third leg, and the most important leg in many ways, is what you see on the bar on the bottom there that says build constructive public awareness. Changing the social norms, doing community awareness around this issue is where we're going to really see movement in terms of a reduction in the amount of sexual exploitation and sex trafficking. So our collaborative that got together several years ago Started with Val Ritchie and I from Val from King County Prosecuting Attorney's Office, and me from Organization for Prostitution Survivors got together, and we wanted to address the issue of demand. And so Val will talk a bit more about that process, but we recognized pretty early on that we needed to make this a coordinated response in the community to the problem of demand. And so we drew in Seattle Against Slavery. Robert Beiser, their executive director, is a member of our core team, and Heidi Sargent from the city attorney's office, and Margaret Evans from Businesses Ending Sex Trafficking. Businesses Ending Slavery and Trafficking, sorry, Margaret. Okay, so I run an intervention program for buyers of commercial sex. One of them in a recent interview put it quite succinctly when I asked him why I buy sex. Why he buys sex. He said, I pay for sex because I love sex, but I hate women. That's exactly what I said when he said that. And then I asked him, I said, well, what do you mean? What do you mean you hate women? He's like, I hate women. I hate women. They've done nothing but hurt me my whole life, and my last girlfriend left me, and I'm not going to trust them anymore, and I'm not going to have relationships with them anymore. I'm just going to pay them. The problem with prostitution is not that it involves sex. The primary problem is the harm experienced by prostituted people. The primary problem with prostitution is that it's not about consent. The problem with that guy who pays for sex but hates women is that he's expecting to get relational needs met through non-relational sex. And that's never going to happen. But it's held out there to men that this is potentially a way that they're going to be able to get their needs met. We're going to unpack that in a little bit. But I want to first ground this presentation that we're doing in the reality of the harm experienced by prostituted people. Right? Because this is not an issue of moralism. This is not saying that sex is bad or something like that. Sex is great if you're doing it right. And if it's consensual, and if it's mutual, and if everybody wants to be doing whatever it is that's happening, it's fantastic. You go. Enjoy. The problem is not that it involves sex. The problem is the harm experienced by prostituted people. And I'm just going to paint a quick picture of the harm. What we know about the harm is that 89% of people in prostitution want to leave the life of prostitution. These stats are all from a study by Melissa Farley on prostitution in 9 countries, where she looked at 854 people presently or formerly in prostitution and asked them questions about their experience of violence. 73% reported being physically assaulted. Imagine 73%, 3 out of 4 people in your workplace being physically assaulted as part of their job. 53% report being raped. Half of the people at your job getting sexually assaulted. 95% experience sexual harassment. I was talking with a woman a couple of years back who used to work up on Aurora. And she would talk about this phenomenon of these boys, high school age boys, that would all get in their cars and drive up and down Aurora harassing the women, throwing bottles at them, yelling the most horrific, hurtful, hateful stuff that you can imagine at these women. What do you think that was about for those boys? Why did they do that? Do you think all the boys in that car wanted to be doing that? You think there was one or two maybe that were just going along with it because they were afraid of the other guy's judgment? Why was it that they were targeting people in prostitution with that? Because people in prostitution have historically been seen as legitimate targets for this type of treatment. Because men, predominantly men, have felt entitled to treat people if they're in prostitution in this way. 75% have been homeless. 68% meet the criteria for PTSD.
which is about twice that as for military veterans. 59% reported physical abuse from a caregiver as a child. It's about 16% in the general population. 63% reports being sexually abused as kids, with an average of 4 perpetrators. In addition to those perpetrators giving these young, predominantly girls, attention, many times they gave them gifts for their silence. Many times they gave them money, setting up this sex for money dynamic pretty early in their life. And you can probably see how a lot of these things fit together, right? The childhood sexual abuse, the physical abuse in childhood is not disconnected from that 75% of experienced homelessness. One thing leads to another. It's a funnel directly into the life. 64% report being threatened with a weapon. 49% have had pornography made in them while in prostitution. Some people see this one and are like, so what, you know? What's the big deal about that one? But this one really is an important one to understand the meaning of. What does it mean for a survivor when she's had pornography made of her and she gets out of the life? That's a record that's never going to disappear, that's always going to be right there, waiting for her. She takes a job, she's working somewhere, she never knows when that's going to surface and she gets fired. She gets into a relationship, she gets married, she doesn't tell the person because she knows that how they'll judge her and how they'll take it out sometimes when they're in arguments, so she doesn't tell him. But she's terrified that someday he's going to find it. I knew a young woman many years ago that I worked with who had a pimp. And she had been raised by her grandmother. And she loved her grandmother. Her grandmother didn't know that she was in the life. And the pimp had made pornography of her. And she was not in touch anymore with her grandmother. Because she was ashamed. And the pimp told her that if she ever tried to get away, that he would send the porn to grandma. Right, so when you think about 49% of that pornography, you know, it's one thing to look at the statistic, it's another thing to understand the meaning of this in the life of a person who's had this record made of them and what it's been used for and what it could be used for. 48% use drugs to cope, 52% use alcohol to cope. A lot of times when I'm doing presentations, I'm sure not in this group, but in a lot of groups, people look at that stat and say, oh, that explains it. People are doing the prostitution in order to pay for the drug habit. And while that's true some of the time, it usually starts the other way around. It's the prostitution that starts, and it's the drugs and alcohol that are used to numb out, that are used to try to dissociate, that are used to try to get away from your body, which is the location of the trauma. You know, if I had to give 5 blowjobs to men I didn't want to tonight, and at the end of it you gave me a drink, I would take it, and I would probably say, will you make that too, and can I have something a little stronger? Not because I want to get high, not because I want to have fun, but because I want to get away from a shitty life. But what happens pretty quickly is you develop a dependency on getting away from your shitty life, on coping with your shitty life. So if at some point she does get away from her pimp, now she's got a chemical dependency, in addition to no employment history, maybe even with a criminal record. Could be one more barrier. 75% report not having a safe place to go. 76% report a need for job training. 47% require drug and alcohol treatment. 61% report having inadequate or no health care. 44% report needing child care. 23%, 1/4 of them, report needing physical protection from pimps. 88% experience verbal abuse and social contempt, even from places that are supposed to help. I worked for a number of years as a homeless service provider, and I was sometimes astonished at the way that my coworkers would treat people that had been in prostitution, as if they were a different class of human being, for which different rules apply. So that buyer said, I bought sex because I love sex and I hate women. This buyer said the same thing in a different way. He said, I buy sex because the only thing I'm more afraid of than intimacy is rejection. The only thing I'm more afraid of than intimacy is rejection. So I pay my money so I don't have to worry about getting rejected. And I don't have to worry about actually having any sort of sense of intimacy or connection or risk, right? Or vulnerability, or any of the relational stuff that's really necessary, which are fundamentally the needs that they're trying to meet. And I know that these needs aren't being met because I've been working with these men for 20 years, and it's backed up by this recent nationwide survey of anonymous sex buyers. 76% of them agreed or strongly agreed with the statement, I would like to stop buying sex. Is that surprising? 76%. So, why are these men buying sex? Why do they think it's going to meet these needs? A lot of it has to do with the social construction of gender. A lot of it has to do with what we're raised to think about what it means to be a man in the world, what it means to be a woman in the world, what it means in terms of how we treat one another. And this training starts really early, right? It's not about biology, it's not about genetics, it's about learned behavior. And the message we get pretty early on, those of us who are raised male, is to act like a man. How many men in this room heard that from older men in your life? Right? Absolutely. If we didn't hear it from our dads or our brothers or our friends, we might have heard it from our sisters, or our moms, or our grandmas, right? Why don't you act like a man? Why don't you be a man? And what are we learning when they're saying you act like a man, be a man? We're learning that we're supposed to be strong. We're learning that we're supposed to be a know-it-all. We're learning that we're supposed to be able to fight and defend ourselves. We're learning that we're supposed to be independent. We're never supposed to ask anybody for anything. We're learning we're supposed to be non-emotional. Big boys don't cry. Suck it up. Be stoic. Man up. There are a couple emotions that are considered okay manly emotions to have, right? Like anger and pride. Horniness is not really an emotion, but it tends to be one of the few ways that men are given to kind of express emotion is through sex. So a lot of things get funneled through that. What do you think? Do you think men and boys have these emotions? Yeah, okay, good start. But we're just taught not to show them, right? How healthy do you think that is? It's not healthy at all. I was talking to my class the other day, and I was like, how healthy do you think that is? And one of the men said, he was like, it's really not healthy at all. He's like, you just bottle it up all up inside, it's just going to come out someday. And I was like, okay, so how's it going to come out? He said, anger. This is when we talk about social emotional learning and the importance of working with boys, especially elementary school boys, around social emotional learning. It's about developing the skills to deal with a full range of emotions and not having to cut off parts of themselves to try and fit into a rigid notion of what it means to be a man in the world. I mean, a lot of the things about that we learn about masculinity are great. But there are significant things that are missing in the things we allow boys to feel. Things like empathy, compassion, the ability to love and be loved. These are really important abilities for folks to have if they're going to be able to have healthy relationships and help us co-create culture that's worth having and culture that's supportive of everybody. So in addition to all the training that we get around other issues, boys get really specific training around sex. We're taught that we're supposed to know about sex, everything about it, before we even become sexual. We're supposed to initiate sexual activity. And sex serves many times as almost a currency within our male peer groups. Right? It's other guys' judgment that we're afraid of. So boys are talking about having sex with girls, trying to have sex with girls, in order to enhance their reputation in the male peer group, lying about sex with girls in order to enhance their reputation in the all-male peer group. That tying of sexual identity with scoring in order to enhance your reputation with your male peers is functional in the lives of a lot of young men. And it impacts the way we think about sex later on. Don't have time to talk to show it here today, but those of you who want to check it out, there's a great TED Talk by a guy by the name of Al Vernaggio, and he talks about sex needing a new metaphor. Here's one, and you can just barely see behind him on the screen to the lower right. Anybody see what's back there? A baseball. Anybody familiar with the baseball metaphor for sex? First base, second base, third base, home. What this metaphor of sex sets up is this antagonistic relationship between the people that are involved. Right? There's a winner and a loser. You're trying to score off somebody and get as far as you can. You're at the party in high school, and you take a walk with a girl, and you come back, and what do your friends say? How far did you get? They're going to measure your manhood by how far you got. Second base, tagged out of third. Where is the space for this young man to be able to wander around the outfield with his hand barely touching his beloved, feeling the energy flow between them, not knowing where this is going to lead, but it's something great right now that's happening between us. Instead, there's a tape playing in his head. Go as far as you can. You got to get home. You got to push. You got to score. And he's going to lose out. He's going to lose out on the intersubjectivity, that space between him and the other. To meet the other in that space, right? That can be magical. That sets our worlds on fire. And he's going to lose out because he's playing baseball in his head to try and prove his manhood to his male peers. And it's going to impact him in that moment, and it's going to impact him later as he enters into relationships. You know, when I talk to men about this stuff, many times they talk about it and say, yeah, that was really true. That was so true in high school. And, you know, I'm really glad that, you know, I'm not in high school anymore and I'm moving away from that. And so many talk about the importance of women as their teachers. That it was actually getting into relationships with women or a true partner that was able to kind of open them up in a way to that intersubjective space, to really appreciating that dynamic between self and other in ways that were sexual, in ways that were intimate and non-sexual. Bell Hooks says, most men think that sex will provide them with a sense of being alive, connected, that sex will offer closeness, intimacy, and pleasure. And more often than not, sex simply does not deliver the goods. This fact does not lead men to cease obsessing about sex. It intensifies their lust and their longing. Again, in a desire to meet relational needs through non-relational sex. And you're not going to get there from here. This participant in my class realized that. He said, I feel horrible. I realized that I was using prostitutes as receptacles for my own shame. They did not deserve that. So, in addition to the gender socialization that we've got for boys, right? Boys are socialized to act like a man. Boys are socialized to think about girls and women in specific ways, and women are, and girls are socialized to think about their own identity, oftentimes through this good girl, bad girl dichotomy, right? Have you ever heard of the good girl, bad girl dichotomy? Okay, right? So, when you think about the good girl and then you think about the bad girl, what is the bad girl? What's the archetype of the bad girl? The person in prostitution. What are the names we have for the bad girl? Slut? Whore? It's no accident that the names for the bad girl are the names for the girl in prostitution. But it's not limited to girls in prostitution or people in prostitution. This good girl, bad girl dichotomy is used to justify violence that happens to many different types of women. How does that happen? Well, think about it. What are the questions that get asked when somebody's been sexually assaulted that blame the victim? What was she wearing? Was she dressed like a fill in the blank? Was she drinking? What's her sexual history? What was she doing with that guy alone? What did she do to bring this on herself? Was she dressed provocatively? What's the root of the word provocative? Provoke? What did she do to bring this upon herself? Because she's a bad girl, because she's a slut, because she's a whore. And again, it doesn't just apply to people in prostitution, although it's often used to blame them for what happens to them. But it happens in domestic violence, right? With batterers, as they're abusing their partners, as they're assaulting their partners, accusing them of infidelity, actually using the language, you're a slut, you're a whore, you deserve what you get. It happens in the case of sexual assault, where men throw money on their victims as they're walking away. The implication, again, she's a slut, she deserves what she gets. The woman who's sexually harassed in the workplace. Why was she wearing that if she didn't want me to grab her? She's asking for it. Right? So, when we're talking about commercial sexual exploitation and gender-based violence, it doesn't just have to do with people in prostitution. It has to do with the whole range, the whole spectrum of forms of sexual and gender-based violence. A survivor of prostitution in Minneapolis many years ago said this quote, and this quote has always stuck with me. Prostitution isn't like anything else. Rather, everything else is like prostitution because it's the model for women's condition. Prostitution is not like anything else. Rather, everything else is like prostitution because it's the model for women's condition. And that was by Evelina Giobbe from WHISPR, one of the best acronyms for an organization ever. Stands for Women Hurt in Systems of Prostitution Engaged in Revolt. She was awesome. But a man in my class said the same thing in a slightly different way. When I was talking to them about the good girl, bad girl dichotomy, you know, he said, hey, there's no good girls and bad girls. And I was like, oh, that's great, this guy figured it out. These are just categories we put in people into and then treat them accordingly. But no, he was not even close to that, because he followed it up with this statement: if you scratch the surface, they're all whores underneath. Which means that he could justify his behavior against anybody. Because deep down they're asking for it, and deep down they want it. And I love sex, but I hate women. So people often ask me about the types of buyers, and I think that the buyers, there's the similarities are really important to look at. But I want to also acknowledge that there are those that have more normal behavior, those that also have more compulsive or addictive behavior, and those that are pathological. A lot of times people will just want to look at one of these types, right? They'll just say, oh, you know, sex buying is just normal. Other people will just say, oh, it's always about addiction or compulsion. We think about 1 in 6 men that buy sex have an addiction or a compulsion involved, and a small amount have pathological types of behavior, but they all exist together. And one of the things that brings them together is that they sit on a foundation of social norms that create this legitimate target group of people who are targeted in different ways for different levels and forms of exploitation, objectification, and violence. On the pathological end, we've got guys like Gary Ridgway. Right? And Ridgway said, I picked prostitutes as my victims because I hate most prostitutes and I did not want to pay them for sex. So I picked them as victims because they were easy to pick up without being noticed. I knew they would not be reported missing right away, might never be reported missing. I picked prostitutes because I thought I could kill as many of them as I wanted without getting caught. And he did. Ridgway admitted to killing 48. We think it was closer to 90 over the course of 20 years. And who did he kill? People in prostitution, right? Precisely for these reasons that he talked about. If he was picking women off of the streets of downtown Seattle at lunch hour, would it have taken 20 years to catch him? He was targeting the legitimate target group. He was also targeting children. Because of Gary Ridgway's 48 admitted victims, 27 of them were between the ages of 15 and 18, which made him the largest child serial killer in the U.S. The fact that many of his victims were children is not mentioned because they were viewed as prostitutes. Right? That's who he killed. Their identity as children, as women, as people, as individuals, is subsumed because they're in this category. Do it to them. That's what they're for. In the compulsive area, I've got this quote from a participant recently that said, I never thought I would say this, but I'm glad I got arrested. I couldn't stop. It forced me to come clean with my wife. It was hard at first, and sometimes it still is, but I don't have to live with the burden of that secret anymore. It might have saved my marriage. Now, this is a cycle of shame that a lot of people who have a compulsive relationship with sex and act out through buying sex experience. But there's also a lot of men who just identify as normal, you know, who this wasn't a compulsion for. I had coffee with this guy and he told me, before he came to the class, he told me, look, I was a good John. I never hurt anybody physically. And I never hurt them emotionally. And then he stopped himself and said, well, I don't think that I did, but it's hard to tell. Because when you're with them, it's like they're wearing a mask. It's like they're not really there. So what is it about this other person being dissociative that makes you think it's great to go ahead and have sex with them? When somebody is not there and looks like they're wearing a mask, it means that they're trying to get out of their body because they don't want to be doing this thing that you're going to be doing together. And why are you so clueless that you can't see that and back up and say, what the hell am I doing? What's wrong with me? And that's where the entitlement piece comes in, and the privilege piece comes in, is that he had blind spots around that. Another normal comment, I always thought that buying sex was just normal for men, that it was just something that we did sometimes. I didn't really think about it. I didn't care about the women. Right? Again, the privilege piece, the entitlement piece, fully there, right? Even though this is not a compulsive behavior necessarily for this guy, or a pathological behavior. And then here's a comment from one of the men who came through my class that is not a sex buyer, because I do have a number of men who actually come through the class. When men approach me at gatherings like this and say, what can I do to help? This sounds great. I say, come on through the class. We've all got our stuff to work on, right? And so this was from one of those men. He said, I signed up for this class because I wanted to understand more about what causes some men to want to buy sex and perpetuate violence against women and children in this manner. What I found is that we as men are all hurting inside to some degree or other. Unless we understand and face our own pain, we are destined to pass that pain on to others around us, whether it is buying sex or behaving badly in our own personal relationships. The corollary with that slide I showed earlier is this, about the normal compulsive and pathological buyers, is the rape culture, right? Which we can all understand, you know, that there's higher levels of sexual assault exist and are experienced disproportionately by women and impact the way that things that are lower on the continuum are experienced. Like, catcall wouldn't have the power that it does if 1 in 4 women were raped in their lifetime. And men experience the world quite differently than women. I'll do a quick experiment here. I'm going to ask 2 questions. First, I want to ask all the men in the room, what do you do to keep yourself safe from rape? And that's the answer I always get. Okay, now for the women in the room, and just shout it out, what do you do to keep yourself safe from rape? Great. Thank you. Thank you. I moved through a different world. I have never been in a bar and put my beer down and stepped away for a moment and looked back and said, oh my gosh, somebody might have put something in that. When I was dating, I never thought twice about going up to somebody's place with them on the first date. I walk down the street and I don't think about being sexually assaulted. One of the things that men say sometimes to answer that question, when I say, what do you do to keep yourself safe from rape, is sometimes they'll say, I don't go to prison. Right? And it's true. It's true because that's one of the places that men get sexually assaulted. In fact, 1 in 10 men that go to prison will be sexually assaulted during this time in prison. And 1 in 4 women will be raped in her lifetime, which means that a man is safer from rape in prison than a woman is just walking around the world. And men, I know, are terrified of going to prison. I can never go to prison. I might get raped there. Well, then what are you going to do about fixing this world for your sisters and for your daughters and for the women you don't even know? Because that's the reality that they're living every day. When I talk about the sexual violence continuum and rape culture and things on the lower end of the continuum, it's all these things that contribute to this environment where sexual assault, sexualized murder, all the things on the far end happen. And these things are all connected and sit on a base of sexual objectification. So what do we do about it? What do we do about this issue in terms of prevention, the preventing demand, in terms of stopping sexual exploitation, in terms of stopping gender-based violence? Well, I think we need to look at a whole spectrum of prevention and intervention with buyers and potential buyers, starting when they're small and going right through as they age. So if we look at this spectrum of prevention, you know, you're going to see an inverted triangle. On the right-hand side, it's going to say primary, secondary, and tertiary forms of prevention. Primary prevention are forms of prevention of preventing things before they even get started. So we're looking at things like parenting, right? Teaching empathy and respect to children. These are things that we do far upstream. Then as we get into secondary prevention, we're talking about middle school and high school prevention curriculum. Not just about commercial sexual exploitation, but it's also focusing on dating violence, on sexual harassment, on bullying prevention, because these things are all rooted in the same issue of lack of social-emotional learning and toxic masculinity. Awareness, promoting men's accountability as a form of secondary prevention. And then as we're moving towards tertiary, we start talking about our online deterrence programs that we use for sex violence, which Robert Beiser is going to talk about a little bit later on, and our outreach, which he's going to talk about as well, and interruption. And then, you know, down at the tip of this triangle, we've got the tertiary forms of prevention, preventing buyers from buying again who have already bought. And so this is the place where law enforcement comes in, arrests, prosecution and conviction, and post-conviction intervention programs like the one that I run. So if we think about, people often ask me about my class, well, does it work? And my answer has to be no, it does not work. It does not work if you think that getting 10 men into a class for 10 weeks every month, right? That's 100 men a year. We've got 6,000 in one day looking to buy ads just by sex on ads at backpage.com. Right, so it's not going to work to just do that tertiary intervention. We've got to talk about a more holistic strategy in terms of reducing demand. Henry David Thoreau, in terms of talking about toxic masculinity, a long time ago, I think said it best in terms about what it does to men. Most men lead lives of quiet desperation and go to the grave with the song still in them, never really able to step into their true humanity, their full humanity, because they embody the hegemonic or toxic masculinity. And when I say this, I'm not meaning to beat up on men at all. I love men. I think men are awesome. Some of my best friends are men. I'm a man. It's not normal in the statistical sense. When we say toxic masculinity is normative, it's not normal in the statistical sense. Only a minority of men ever might enact it. But it embodies a currently favored, respected, or feared way of being a man and requires all men to position themselves in relation to it. It's that group of high school kids that's driving, harassing the women on the street in Aurora, and 3 out of the 5 kids in the car don't want to be doing that, but they're afraid of the one jackass who's driving and who's the most loudest and crassest of the bunch. They're afraid that they're going to get called out. They're afraid that they're going to get kicked out of the group. What it also does, in terms of requiring men to position themselves in relation to it and each other, is it ideologically legitimates the subordination of women to men. And what it does to men, I had to throw this quote from Gary Shandling. He said, my friends tell me I have an intimacy problem, but they don't know me. I was teaching my class last night, and we're doing this active listening exercise, and I'm giving them these prompts. And so there's, you know, a group of men who are the talkers, and some group who are the listeners. And I give them this prompt. I said, "Talk about an intimate relationship you had that's not sexual." And there was silence. One of them looks up and goes, "What? Talk about an intimate relationship you had that's not sexual." Your connection to others. Right? Sex and intimacy gets fused in toxic masculinity. So if we're looking at sex buying, how much time do I got, Robert? I did, but I shut it off. I have like a minute. Oh, 8 minutes, that's perfect. Totally on time. So again, when we're looking at sex buying, it is an individual problem for men who buy sex. But it's not just an individual problem for men who buy sex. It's also a social problem, and it's a social practice, right? We've got to look at not just the buyer, not just that spectrum of prevention that I was talking about that's targeting the individual buyers, But we've got to look at everything, the culture that surrounds the buyer. And what we decided to do pretty early on with the Ending Exploitation Collaborative is to break that down into sectors and to figure out how to engage these sectors and how to involve them in creating a culture worth having, where everybody's valued, where mutuality and consent are valued. And so, one of the places, the place that we started was criminal justice, but this is how the sectors break out in terms of the model that we're developing. You know, we talk about criminal justice, we also talk about government and social services being important, both to the buyer's side and to the side of those who have been exploited. The health sector is incredibly important, as are the public awareness sector, as is the work that Mara's going to talk to you later on with BEST, Businesses Ending Slavery and Trafficking, in terms of engaging businesses. Robert's going to be talking with us later on as well about the education and technology sectors. So really being able to have different strategies in each of these particular sectors in order to change the culture and in order to move the needle on this issue. And the two of the sectors I'm going to talk to you about in the next 7 minutes are the health sector and then the government social service sector. And I think the health sector is important to talk about because if we look fundamentally at the issue of buying sex and the prostitution of commercial sexual exploitation, I want to just talk about the definition of sexual health from the World Health Organization. And the way the World Health Organization defines sexual health is sexual health is a state of physical, mental, and social well-being in relation to sexuality. It requires a positive and respectful approach to sexuality and sexual relationships, as well as the possibility of having pleasurable and safe sexual experiences free of coercion, discrimination, and violence. I asked the men in my class a few weeks back when they were starting, we read this, and I said, what do you think, does sex buying fit in here? And to the number, they were like, no, not at all. Because they know. They know that they're paying to not hear the truth about this other person's experience. They know that this other person is likely experiencing harm. When I ask them, and I do, first night, I say, suppose you pick up somebody on the track or somebody on the internet who's 15 years old, and you ask them how old they are, what are they going to say? And they say to the number, they say, well, she's going to say she's 18, 21. And then I follow it up and say, and if you ask them if they have a pen, even if they do, what are they going to say? And to the number, they say, well, they're going to say no. And if you ask them, do they like what they're doing, even if they don't, what are they going to say? They answer, well, they're going to say yes. And that's the thing about sex buying. It's called a trick for a reason. It's called a trick because they're paying for the illusion of consent and the illusion of mutuality and the illusion that this person wants to be with them. And they're paying to not hear about the reality of her or his lived experience. It is not a practice of sexual health. So what I'd like to see happen in the health sector is that sex buying be seen as the harmful practice of gender-based violence, and that it's both a public health and an individual problem. And in terms of engaging the health sector, we need a few things. We need robust exit services, not just for victims and survivors of third-party exploitation, right? It's not just for people who have been pimped. At my organization, OPS, we serve a lot of folks who have been in prostitution and who have been hurt in prostitution who didn't have a trafficker, who maybe got in when they were over 18, who were hurt. When we focus only on trafficking, who are the people that don't think that they belong in services anymore? Who don't think that their victimization is seen as real, who blame themselves because they didn't have a third-party exploiter. I think that the trafficking, anti-trafficking community needs to talk more about this issue. Not just exit services for victims and survivors of third-party exploitation, but exit services that are available to anybody who wants out of being commercially sexually exploited by the buyer. Right? A lot of times when people think of exploitation, they think of the pimp. Well, in a lot of domestic sex trafficking, she actually has more contempt for the buyers than she does for the pimp, because she's got a relationship with the pimp, like a domestic violence relationship. But she has a hell of a lot of contempt for the buyers. Right? That is a form of exploitation as well. And I'm not going to, I don't know, I have only a few minutes left, so I won't go too far into that. So what we need to develop is a violence prevention public health model. So to talk with, engage public health and move them away strictly from harm reduction and more towards a violence prevention analysis when it comes to commercial sexual exploitation. This is some work that we're doing in King County now, and it's very exciting. In terms of working with health providers, have them recognize that if men are buying sex, that they have a problem. And have therapists aware that sex buying is not just the problem of infidelity. That if somebody comes to them and talks about their sex buying, that they're able to make a referral. Because there's a problem there. I'm doing a CEU training for therapists next week with a guy by the name of Dr. James Olson, and we're going to be talking about a lot about buyer typology, but a lot about social norms change for therapists specifically, because therapists have the same blind spots that other people in all of these sectors have, which is why the public awareness that we're doing in all of these sectors is so important. So providers should be able to make the referrals to Stopping Sexual Exploitation, which is my class or something or others. And in general, action steps that can be taken around, because I was told, make sure you include action steps. Because for you awesome folks who are up here who are trying to engage in this type of work and trying to create your own model up here, which is amazing. You know, so I can tell you a little bit about what we did, and I'm sorry if my action steps are a little loose and not so, but it's kind of like improvisation. You got to figure out what to do. You got to do outreach. Find people, health providers, therapists. Start talking to people about these issues. Educate, share your knowledge, and build relationships. Find the leaders in these particular sectors, especially in the health sector. Therapists, public health people, primary health providers, clinics. Identify people who get it and who are supportive of the work that you're doing in those areas. And then what we did is convene a health sector leadership team. People love to be on a leadership team. Invite them in. Get pizza. And work with them to get knowledgeable and to become leaders in their fields and be able to recruit folks in their particular sectors and empower and support those leaders to organize in their fields. Right. Robert tells me I've got 1 minute left to talk about government and social services. Luckily, this part's really easy. That's a joke. So laws, policies, and practices. We've got to promote laws, policies, and practices that develop and maintain robust exit services for people who have been exploited, that promote men's accountability to end sex buying, and that support community education to change social norms. You'll see once again the three legs of the Nordic model stool: services for survivors, accountability for those who are exploit, and then changing the social norms. In terms of the tertiary prevention of sex buying, they can, I'm not gonna have time to talk about my program. which luckily, how many people were here last year? Okay. So grab one of those people on the break and they'll tell you about the program because they heard about it last year. Government's role in tertiary prevention of sex buying. If you don't have a job school or a sex buyers intervention program here, you should have one. And it should be community-based, and it should be about transformative justice. If people are interested in starting one, please talk to me, I want to work with you, and we can arrange a time where I'll give you a lot more information about the class that I do that's called Stopping Sexual Exploitation, a Program for Men, because it's a really, I think it's a very exciting model, and I'm not going to talk about it here, but what we found is that it has really changed these men's attitudes about prostitution. 82% agreed that they were going to talk to other men about the negative impacts of buying sex. That's one of the things that I was very blown away by, is that not only were these men agreeing that they weren't going to buy sex anymore, but that they were going to talk to other men about not buying sex. And 96% said that they would not buy sex again. I think one of them left it blank, so hoping he just didn't see it. Okay, in terms of taking action in the government social services sectors, and this is again specifically on demand, outreach, build those relationships, support and advocate for all of those legs of the Nordic model stool. And in addition to that, something that is a kind of a low-hanging fruit that you can do to get things on board is a proclamation. And we did one in King County when we launched our initiative, the Ending Exploitation Collaborative Initiative. We got people from all the different municipalities, city councils to sign on board to a proclamation. I don't have time to talk about that now, although Robert Beiser is going to be part, it's going to be part of his presentation when he talks this afternoon, so be sure to stick around after lunch. And that's it for me. We're going to take, I think, about how long of a break? 10-minute break right now. We're good. Val Ritchie set up, and he's going to take us in to talk about the criminal justice sector. Thank you all.